moment to say thank you to all of you, to our ushers, to our deacons, to our media ministry, to music ministry, to choir, to mothers of our church. Each of you in your respective places, thank you for all that you do. Not doing anything, and I thank you for what you're doing.
All right, all right.
Pray with me, Father. We live in times that are troublesome. We have so many questions of what the future holds for us. As we look at our government, our leaders, and political scene, it would appear, God, that we are in a state of despair. But I thank you, God, that you are the one who is in control. That Romans 8 and 28 has never stopped being a reality. So I pray now, God, that you would encourage our congregation, that you would encourage Christians all. Now, as we prepare to give a word for you, I pray, God, that you would remove me from myself. Speak to me and through me. A word, God, that is relevant, a word that is powerful, a word that convicts and converts, a word that will sustain us throughout the week. Open our spiritual ears so we can hear in the spiritual realm. Open our natural eyes that we might see not only naturally, but in the spiritual realm. Now, God, as I've asked so many times before, I pray that you allow the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart to be accepted by my sight, who are my strength and my redeemer. From the passage of scripture that was read in Galatians 4, chapter 4, verses 8 through 13, I won't read them again. I will read some of them again. So, what we find here that Paul is talking to the church at Galatia, a church that had been converted, that he had made a confession of faith. Some of them were polytheistic, serving many gods. Some of them were in Judaism and practicing the laws of Judaism. And Paul came to the knowledge that many of them were converting back to their old ways. Perhaps you would understand it in the phrase that says they had fallen off the wagon. Those of you that are familiar with those who are addicts, they had gone and had been clean, and all of a sudden they fell off for whatever reason. Almost to the point that Paul wondered if his teachings had been in vain. And perhaps if you could use your spiritual imagination, you could imagine if you had been teaching your child or teaching someone something and it seemed as though they had it, and you could let them go out on their own, and all of a sudden, down the line, it looked as if they had lost everything that you had taught them. You can imagine how disgusted you would be. You can imagine how upset and how hurt you might be. And if you can imagine that, then you can put yourself in the frame of mind that Paul speaks to this church in Galatia. And it's because of this tug of war that we have as Christians, this tug of war in the spiritual realm, that I want to ask you a question this morning. And that question is, I wonder if anybody here remembers playing the game that we call tug of war. If you don't remember playing it, if you never played it, let me explain to you the goal of the game. After putting an equal number of participants on opposite sides of a rope, was for one side to pull the other side across the line that was in the middle. Oftentimes, a flag was attached to the middle of the road band, or the line would be in the middle of a mud pit, resulting in some of the losing team being drugged in the mud.
Right.
My brothers and my sisters, if we think about it, save the unsaved or the backslider, each of us are faced with a spiritual tug of war each and every day. And so it's from our scripture text and from this concept of a tug of war that I invite your undivided attention for a few minutes to the sermon, how to avoid being pulled back to the other side. How to avoid being pulled back to the other side. To explain this sermon, we are going to use the acrostic SAVE. So all week long, if you can think of SAVE, you ought to be able to put this sermon and reconstruct it in a summarized format throughout the week. Using SAVE as we look at it, the S stands for separation. Look at verse number 8. It says, but then indeed, when you did not know God, you served those which by nature are not gods. In other words, when he says, when you were serving idols, when you didn't know the God, the Most High God, that you served idols, you served other gods. But listen what he says in verse number 9a. There's a conjunction there. It says, but now.
All right.
Some of us say, but now the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God. We may do for a night, but joy comes in the morning time. There's a but, and when the but comes in, it changes the situation. And so Paul, in the case that there was a separation here, he says, but now, after you have known God, or rather, are known by God. My brothers and sisters, it was General George S. Patton that said, you need to overcome the tug of people against you as you reach for high goals. Many of you understand, you've heard the ideology or the idiom of the crab mentality. And as you try to climb out, somebody, even your friends or your family, try to grab you and pull you back down. They don't want to see you get out of the state that you're in, because it seems as though that you're going to leave them. And so General Patton would suggest that sometimes you got to separate yourself from some people. My brothers and my sisters, if we're going to be successful in our Christian walk, we must separate ourselves from our past. We must separate ourselves from some people, and we must separate ourselves from all philosophies.
Yes, yes.
We can't think like we used to. We can't walk like we used to. We can't hang out with some of the same folks that we used to. A scripture to support this idea can be found in 2 Corinthians 6, chapter 6, verses 14 through 18. It says, be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Oftentimes, folks use this in marriage, but it's also in everyday life. For what fellowship have righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion have light with darkness? And what concord have Christ with Baal? Or what part has he that believeth with an infidel? Verse number 6, he says, and what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. He's talking about each one of us. We are the temple, but we have made our profession of faith and have become a Christian and a follower of the Most High God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. If we understand that if we are God's people, he walks in us and he talks in us, there ought to be a difference in what we do. We ought to understand that we have to be separated from the world. Verse 17 says, wherefore come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. Finally, verse 18 says, and I will be a father unto you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. My brothers and my sisters, you may be asking yourselves, how can I separate from my family that I have to be in contact with? You might ask yourself the question, how can I separate myself from a spouse that does not believe the same things that I believe? You might ask yourself, how can I separate myself from the people that are on my job unless I quit or get fired? You might ask yourself, how can I separate myself from my neighbor? will deserve to be answered, church. I believe that while the Bible directs us to make some physical separations, that there are some mental and spiritual separations that must be made. If you dare to a person that doesn't believe you, you have to separate yourself mentally and spiritually from the things that they want to do that's of the world. If you are on your job and you can't leave and they're not saved, you have to physically, mentally, and spiritually separate yourself from what they're doing. You can't get in every conversation. You can't go to every event and social event that they have. You can't hang around at the water cooler and talk the trash that they talk to at the water cooler. You are in the world, but not of.
All right.
While we make you a necessity before us to associate with some people or frequent some establishments, we can separate ourselves from their ideologies of people and of organizations. My brothers and my sisters, if we are to avoid being pulled back to the other side, we must not only separate ourselves from our past, separate ourselves from some people, separate ourselves from our own philosophy, but we must also alter our thinking and our action. The A in saved is alteration. Look at verse number 9b. The writer says, how is it that you turn again to the weak and beggarly elements to which you desired again to be in bondage? In other words, what he's insinuating here is that you made some alterations. You changed your life. You changed the way that you think. You changed who you went around. But now you are going back. Church, the language here is a call to a life of alteration. The people of Galatia found themselves in a tug of war. It is believed that most of them who either practiced Judaism or polytheism prior to their conversion. The text indicates that so many of them seem to have pulled back or gone back to their old practices that the writer wonders if his teachings had been in vain. Notice verse number 11. He says, I am afraid for you, lest I have labored for you in vain. And I'm going to tell you as a preacher, I'm going to tell you as your pastor, that when the leader comes to the point that he or she feels that their labor is in vain, it's a sad situation. My brothers and my sisters, the idea of a life alteration or a changed person is weaved throughout the Bible. In Isaiah 43, 18 and 19, the word declares, do not remember the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth, shall ye not know it? I will even make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. In other words, God says that in your wilderness, where it looks like it's a desert, I will put a road for you to travel on. Can you see it in the spiritual realm? He says, when you're in the desert and there's no water, I will give you something to drink. In other words, don't go by what it looks like, because you know that your life has been altered.
Yes.
When you know the life has been altered, you can say to folks, say, I remember you when. I remember when you were turning up a pint of Jack Daniels. I remember when you would light up a blunt. I remember when you couldn't get, you would get drunk and didn't know how to get home. And you can say, I can remember then too. My God! My life has been altered. Would you like to know about the person who altered my life? So then you can say, but then.
Yes, yes.
The book of John 3 and 3, Jesus answered and said to him, most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Why be born again and live like you were in the old times? Now, if you're born again, that means that you look new, you walk new, you learn new stuff. You are a whole different person. Learn that we need to become new. There's too many of us still talking like we used to. still walking like we used to walk to. Many of us still going to the same old Jew joint that we used to go to. Too many of us still turning up the same Bible that we used to turn up. And so I'm going to keep saying that if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away, Lord, all things have become new. Church, I don't have to say much more on this point because the Bible speaks for itself. As we move on in our understanding of how to avoid being pulled back to the other side, we've covered our need for separation. We've just considered making an alteration to our life. And so next we will look at our visualization. Listen with me in verse number 12a of our text. It says, brethren, I urge you to become like me. My brothers and my sisters, I can hear the teacher saying, look at me and become like me. It was his teacher said to follow me as I follow Christ. This was not a foreign concept in that day. This concept embodies the definition of disciple. To be who the teacher is. Not just to follow and to learn, but you pattern your life, you imitate the teacher. Church, I would suggest to you that there is an underlying call to the church to visualize the mind of Christ, to visualize the character of Christ, and to visualize the actions of Christ, our teacher, and then mentally see themselves operating in the same mind, operating in the same character, and operating in the same action. I don't know about you, but if you pay attention to any of the leadership of tapes that were videos online or on YouTube or read any self-help books on leadership, many of them tell you that in order for you to be successful, you have to visualize yourself doing and having what it is that you want. Because if you can't see it, you can't get it. And what I'm saying is, if you can't see yourself walking like Jesus, if you can't see yourself talking like Jesus, and you can't see yourself acting like Jesus, you'll find yourself losing the battle in the tug of war. And so you got to picture yourself not cursing no more. You got to picture yourself not homewoman no more. You got to picture yourself not getting drunk no more. You got to picture yourself not in homosexuality no more. You got to picture yourself delivered. But the sisters did not. The teacher said, brother, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which were behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Did not Jesus the Christ admonish his followers to do as he did? Did he not tell them to be imitators? If you don't believe me, John 13, verse 12 through 15 says, so when he had washed their feet and taken his garment and reclined at the table again, he said to them, do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right. So I am. If I then, the Lord and the teacher, wash your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. In other words, what Jesus said is, if I could humble myself down low enough to wash your feet, if I could just put it in modern day vernacular, if I could get down and wash the crud out from between your sticky toes, if I could wash the crud and I'm running on your feet, then you ought to be able to do the same for your brothers and sisters. He wasn't saying this, it's an act of humility. Yes. John 13, 34 says, a new commandment I give you, that you love one another even as I have loved you, that you also love one another. I can hear that the Bible say, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation and looked upon him the form of a servant. Imagine that. God coming down in the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of man. And being found in the fashion of a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. My brothers and my sisters, Hosanna, if we're going to avoid being pulled back to our old simple ways of thinking and living, we must stop visualizing the old. Stop visualizing to the other side. We must separate from our past, negative people, and from old philosophies. We must alter our thinking and our actions. We must visualize walking as our Savior walked, and finally, we must continue moving forward until our soul has been emancipated. My brothers and my sisters, the E in this acrostic say is emancipation. I would suspect that many of us can understand the concept of emancipation better than others. Some of us that are older know what we went through and what our parents went through. And so when we talk about emancipation, it's not just from something that we read in our textbooks. When we talk to millennials, emancipation to them is just something that their grandma and their great-grandma and their parents talk about. But so that I don't get you caught up with just my opinion, I looked at what Mr. Webster had to say about the definition of emancipation. And there were three definitions that we're going to look at, the first and the third. He said first is to free from resistance. To free from restraint, control, or the power of another, especially to free from bondage. Somebody said that we once were bound in sin. By this definition, we can be thankful for our seeking freedom from the bondage of sin. In the event someone does not know, I want to inform you today that the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus the Christ. If we look at the definition number three, it says, we should be able to appreciate the emancipation of our mind. Definition number three says, to free from any controlling influence as traditional morals or beliefs. Some of us were caught up in some stuff. We were addicts and needed to go and say, my name is so-and-so, and I am. And I want you to understand that we understand that we've been emancipated from that. God has freed our minds. Well, I'll move on to our final emancipation. We should seek, my brothers, while we should seek them and maintain spiritual emancipation here on earth. There is an emancipation that won't take place on this land. Somebody wondering what type of emancipation is that, Reverend M? And I'm glad you asked me that question. That emancipation is the emancipation of our souls. This emancipation that becomes a driving force in our total war of life. Wow, I can't speak for anybody else here today. I can look back over my life, and as I think things over, I can't help but realize that this old building of mine, it keeps on leaving. And I can't help but to look forward to the time that my soul can move to another home. I heard the Bible presented in this way. It says, for we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God. Somebody ought to get happy. A house not made with hands. Eternal in the heavens. Christ, church, that's why I challenge each of you that have made a confession of faith unto the Lord to separate yourselves from your old way of thinking. Separate yourself from your old way of living. The altar, the spiritual food that you eat, and the way you think. Alter your actions. Visualize yourself imitating Jesus the Christ. And then do it on a continual and a deliberate basis. And finally, maintain your emancipation from sin. Your emancipation in the spiritual realm from Satan. And walk toward your soul's emancipation. Well, as I close out the day, I use my spiritual imagination. I need all the teens to come on up. These to come swiftly and fast. So that we can go ahead and get into our community. I want to use a demonstration that demonstrates how we can avoid being pulled back into our sin. What I need Chris, I want you to come on this side. Courtney, I want you to go all the way to the back on that side. You can't help but lean it on this. I need you to come on this side. Tatiana, I want you to come over on this side. I need you all in a straight line. You in the back, you ain't. Somebody said, well, that's not a rope. I know it's not a rope. You just stick with the illustration. Put that around here, Courtney. Boy, that one's sticking out. I don't have much stuff in it. Courtney, you're doing all by itself. All right, I want you to stand right here. Come on this side. You stand on this side. Face the rope, and if you don't grab it. I need you to get right there. Right there. Satyam. Grab that as best you can with your hand. Alright, come over here. Somebody already said, this is not going to work. And I need you to come stand right here. I'm changing your position. Using my spiritual imagination. I'm not a preacher, I was just talking. Using my spiritual imagination, when we think of a tug of war, some of you say, well, Rev, that's not a rope. And then some of you say, well, Rev, it's not long enough. But I want you to understand, I want you to see this in the spiritual realm. And so in the spiritual, recording, this is just for demonstration only. All right, so don't get upset, but I picked you because you're the biggest.
Yeah.
All right? And so he's representing Satan just for demonstration. And notice he's anchored.
Yeah.
All right? The rope is not going anywhere. He is the anchor for it. Now, he got some helpers on the side. And you notice, some of you are saying, well, why don't we have some help? Why Tatiana don't have any help on that side? But I want you to see this in the spiritual realm. Tatiana, she got it. She got the rope. Now I want you to say that in the spiritual realm, there's no rope there. There is a spiritual pool. And in that spiritual pool, the rope there is just for you to see that there's some opposition on one side. Now, Tatiana, I want you to turn it this way for a moment. Now, before she got saved, she was on this side. And on this side, I want you to understand, I didn't bring it, I'm going to bring a black plastic bag. And if you can imagine, you know, in the professional tug of war, they got a big old mud pit right here. And so using your spiritual imagination, I want you to imagine everything on this side is a mud pit.
All right.
He's anchored in the mud pit. Everything over here is a mud pit. Tatiana used to be in the mud pit. But what happened was after salvation, she turned to the other side.
Yeah.
The scripture lesson was telling us that the Galatians had turned to the other side. They had came out of the mud pit. Right? But what happened was, after they came out of the mud pit, when you come out of the mud pit, let go. She had let go.
Yeah.
But when she came out, she began to think about where she used to go. She began to think about how much fun she had used to have. She began to think about how good that drink tasted. And she left. And she grabbed a hold of me.
Yes.
Now I want you to understand something. That tug of war, she's got it, and she's held on. And what she don't realize is that she's back in the mud again. And if she's going to avoid being pulled back, all right, now she's already got it. She's holding on to it. There's some help over here.
Oh, yeah.
somebody said, why did he hold on to her? Why did he hold on? Because the help is not.
Yes.
And God's got all power.
Yes. All power.
In his hands.
Yes.
He don't have to hold the rope.
Say that.
Because all he has to do is speak the word.
Yes.
And so when she get caught up on that side, all you got to do is say, God, help me.